see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.
Welcome back, everyone. WIBG 390-1020. Welcome home show. My name is Joe Griffies. We're here with just a whole bunch of people here today, and a lot of people came at very, very young ages. T.
Yes.
There's so much about you. You want to do something to help veterans besides just a memorial, correct?
I do. Yeah, that was one of my first original things. I wanted to personalize my feelings of appreciation for them. So with that, we decided that we were going to find as many Vietnam veterans as possible, and we're going to start off with our town of Barnegat and personally invite them to a night out to thank them, basically. And we were going to feed them beer and feed them pizza and feed them Vietnamese food and talk to them and really get to know them and listen to their stories about their time in Vietnam, just to kind of show them that as a Vietnamese refugee, I was personally invested in making sure that they realized how much I appreciated everything that they did.
Well, when you do that down here in South Jersey, we'll get you a good deal of brunies. We just had Ambassador Murphy, Congressman Brady, Senator Beach, Senator Van Drew.
Oh, yes, that's
we
right.
Had
that's
200,
right.
200 people. Joe, you were there for that show in brunies, right?
Yes.
We had enough voters there to get Murphy in office.
It was. You've had Murphy down here a couple times, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah, right now. Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, that's good.
I was just going to say, right now we have a facility, a venue that is amazing, that is allowing us to host our events there for free. And it is called the Backward Flag Brewery in Forked River, New Jersey. And it is a veteran owned and operated microbrewery. And she had done two tours in Iraq. And so she's a veteran herself, and it's owned, and she's opening up her brewery just for our event.
That is fabulous. One of my heroes is on the phone now. Lucy, you with us?
I don't know that I'm a hero in any way, shape, or form, Joe Griffies, but I'm talking to one. I know that.
And you are the anchor on Fox 29 News in Philadelphia?
Yeah, I do. I get to go on TV five nights a week and be a journalist. Yes, indeed.
Right. Now, let me tell you what I brag about you for. What size? What is Philadelphia considered size-wise as the market goes around the country?
It's market size 4, but as we all know, size does not matter when it comes to the quality of a television station or mm-hmm. the quality of the people within the community. Because I've worked everywhere. I've worked in New York, Los Angeles, Houston, Detroit, here. The list goes on.
And I had the honor of meeting you around 11 o'clock. No, it must have been around 9:30 at the Corcoran's house the night the flag was stolen. And Tom Corcoran comes out and said, there's a lady on Fox News. She wants to know about the Frankie Evans. Can you tell her real fast? And we got that flag back, Bill and Joe. We got that flag back on account of the support we got from you and your station.
Well, it was, you know, one of these things that just grabbed my heart when I found out about this casket flag. And it was really the only part of their brother that they had left because they never found his body, right? He went down with the ship. And so, you know, they carried on the tradition set by their father to raise this every, you know, once a year during this momentous occasion. And that somebody would steal that flag that represented everything to them was heartbreaking to me. So when I heard that story, I knew that I would do everything within my power to at least get the word out, so people knew this was happening, and that whoever stole it realized what they did. It wasn't just every American flag is precious in my eyes, but it wasn't just another American flag. This was a flag that meant something and means something to an entire family. So it was important for us to get it back. And the way they got it back was so interesting. I'm sure you've talked about it on the station, Joe, right?
Yeah, Luce, I'm going to hold you up. Ambassador Tull, you with us?
I'm still here.
We're going to let you go, but I just want to say thank you. And I want to introduce you to Lucy Noland, who's on TV every night. I know you watch Fox 29 News, Ambassador.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. And while you're on, before we let you go, because we have a doctor that we want to bring up before we go off the air. I'm on the Cochran's porch. Everybody's upset. The flag was stolen. They're crying. They're swearing. They want to go house to house to look for the flag. A guy in this room wanted to get a drone the next day and fly it over the town looking for people from around the country. And I'm talking to Lucy, and I said, well, you're really passionate about this. She says, yeah. I says, what makes you more passionate than anybody? She says, where were you born, Luce?
Saigon, Vietnam.
How did that come about?
Well, my father was a U.S. Naval officer, and he eventually got brought up into the State Department, and he was working with the agency and was stationed at the U.S. Embassy in Saigon, Vietnam. And my mom's oldest brother, Uncle Nguyen, he was the lead liaison between the South Vietnamese and the American Red Cross. And then my mom and my dad ended up meeting, fell in love, had me, and the rest is history.
Ambassador Tull, you were in that embassy, correct?
Yeah. What years was your father working at the embassy?
This was in the 60s. So I think it was long before your time, most likely.
Well, I don't know. I got there 68.
Well, we were gone. We were already gone by then. Because you know how it goes, Ambassador. When one of your people marries a national in a war-torn country,
it can
compromise security. But the State Department loved him. But he loved my mom more than he loved his job, and my mom loved him. And so he gave up everything that he had worked for to marry my mom, adopt my oldest brother, and bring us back to the States and start over again. And my mom left everything behind she had ever known because, here's this Vietnamese woman. But, all of a sudden in the United States, long before there were a lot of Vietnamese people here, there was no immersion program for my brother, this 9-year-old little brown boy that was in Eugene, Oregon. But we all thrived, and my mom took her citizenship test, and that was one of my proudest days, watching my mom take her oath of allegiance to the U.S. It was pretty cool.
Ambassador, we're going to let you go. You know we love you. You're the greatest Vietnam veteran we know.
Nice meeting all of your guests today, Joe. Thanks for including me.
Oh, you're the main one. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, bye-bye.
Now, Lucy, we're going to try and bring up Dr. Lee. John's going to try and get her up because, Lucy, it's important that we introduce you. I'd like to introduce you to T. And T was 1.5 years old when her family brought her to the United States. I believe it was April 29th of 1975, right around the fall or something.
Wow. It was April 30th. It was the very
I'm off a day.
Yes,
okay.
Yes. It was
6 months. That's supposed to make me look bad. You know that, don't you? Look. And she came with her brother that was 18 days old.
Yep. Yep, exactly.
No Pampers on that ship, I bet, were there?
Probably. I don't think so. And if they were, they were reused. But, I mean, we took, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 ships. And one plane and, four different countries in order to get to Indian Town Gap, which was the refugee camp.
I have trouble with that. You leave Vietnam, you go to the Philippines.
Yeah.
You go to Guam.
Yeah.
How the hell do you end up in Indian Town Gap, Pennsylvania?
Well, we didn't have a choice.
Of all the places in the world, Indian Town Gap.
Yeah, well, we wanted America. The other choices were like France and Canada, and everybody wanted America. And there were only 4 refugee camps in America, and they were quickly filling up. So we didn't really have a choice as to which refugee camp we were going to be going to, and so we got Indian Town Gap. But we were lucky because our whole family was able to get to Indian Town Gap. Our whole family was able to escape, first of all. And nobody died. Even the dog survived.
That's great.
You were born in Vietnam.
I was born in Vietnam.
Where were you born at?
I was born in Saigon, Vietnam.
Now, do you remember the hospital?
No, I don't remember the day that I was born.
She was a year and a half, Joe.
Well, Lucy, you were. How do you remember? Did your parents tell you? Do you remember the hospital that you were born in?
No, not at all. I was a year and a half when I came here too. I was a year and a half old as well. But I will tell you something interesting. There are certain feels or smells that suddenly bring back a memory. I mean, I was actually interviewing a wonderful Vietnam veteran named Billy Terrell in New York City. We were walking by this compound of sorts on Central Park East, and I looked up, and there was this wrought iron fence, and it just flashed a memory. And I had said to them, I said, that for some reason reminds me of Saigon. And I was talking to my dad, and lo and behold, there were these big, huge wrought iron fences that were these glorious fences around the U.S. Embassy compound, too. So, who knows if that was something that I actually remembered, but it certainly felt like a deja vu moment to me.
You know, my friend Terry Williamson, who's the president of the Vietnam Veterans Wall in Philadelphia, he used to take trips back of veterans to go to Vietnam for a lot of reasons, for healing, for closure, for whatever. And he said it's all changed, highways and buildings and everything. He said, but the only thing that reminded him of being in Vietnam was the smell. Lucy, I'd like to introduce you to Joe Waters.
Hi, Joe Waters.
Good. How are you doing, Lucy?
And I'm well.
And Lieutenant Colonel Adam.
Miklovis.
Miklovis is here. And Bill Davenport also was a Marine Vietnam veteran. And Joe lost a leg in Vietnam, and he came home to be the 8-time national judo champ. He should have got the Medal of Honor, but he's a very, very humble guy. But you and T have something in common, your love for dogs. T. Lucy, you got to write this. Can you give your webpage where they can talk about your Eskies, they can see your Eskies? Tell us that.
Well, we have a trick dog team as well. And so there are three American Eskimo dogs, and we do various performances around the area, and we've performed at military bases because we have our star dog also salutes on the military command of present arms. So it's a pretty
cool. We can't get politicians to do that.
So it's kind of pretty cool. But if you were to Google Atka the Amazing Eskie, ATKA the Amazing Eskie, Eskie, you'll find him everywhere. He's on all social media sites.
Unbelievable. And Lucy, you know, you retrieve dogs, correct?
I rescue dogs and cats and anything else that needs help.
Well, you know,
in fact, once I hang up here, I'm actually going to go rescue a chinchilla from a cruelty case that the SBCA faced. Well, so that's literally where I'm going next.
Okay, but we are doing our show. I might as well tell these guys now. A couple days before Veterans Day, we're going to tape 4 hours at the Camden County Prison. Correctional facility, they don't like to call them prisons anymore, because they are now training service dogs. So Veterans Center,
it's a wonderful program.
10 and 20,000. Maybe you'll come over and do some filming, Luce.
We'll talk. Well, because they're great programs all the way around. They're great programs for the people involved, and it's great programs for the animals involved, and then there's fruition to even better things that these animals can help other people down the line. And then these people that are there have new skills. It's win-win all the way around.
And I know we want to thank you for your support for the Frankie Evans, because we're going to get that done.
You know, it's got to get done. It is absolutely ridiculous to me that because they were outside of the theater of war, even though they had just been there, that they cannot have their names on the wall. That makes no sense. I don't get it. So it's got to be rectified, and I would very much like to help the family get that done.
And you MC when we needed you, Sugar House. How was that night when all the Vietnam veterans came back from Washington? You were at Sugar House that night.
Oh, it was so amazing, right? You know, I wish I could have seen the entire group coming down 95, because I understand that all the fire departments were there. People were waving flags. It was the homecoming that they should have always had.
20 miles.
I'm sure I would have been crying.
20 miles, Lucy, of both sides of 95 were blocked off. Lucy, we're going to only hold you. We got to go to a fast break. You know about that. But we want to bring you back. I want to introduce you to Dr. Lee, who came to the United States when she was, I believe, 15 years old, 16 years old. She came on a wooden boat that held 50 people, but they had 250 people on the boat. And she's a very successful doctor in Philadelphia. And she's very supportive of the Vietnam veterans. You listen to Welcome Home Show. We're going to bring everybody back on the other side.